This is Tom with the community team, and we're going to take a look at tips from the field file blocking profile. If you've ever wondered where to start when configuring a file blocking profile, or which file types might be useful to include, this video may help you figure out which file types are of interest to you. Let's quickly create a new file blocking profile and take a look at some of the file types. What we frequently see is that administrators do set file blocking profiles for executables or PE files because those are well-known file types known to contain malware. Several other file types are easily ignored and can be just as malicious. HLP or LNK files, or help and link, are file types primarily used by Windows operating system to provide assistance to users. But usually there's no real reason to download those from the internet without a good reason to do so. So unless you do frequently download these files, it might be recommended to go ahead and block these. Another one of those neglected file types is the SCR file type, which is primarily used by installable screensavers. Back in the 90s, these were very popular to share screensavers and quickly became a very good transport method for malware because everyone was sharing screensavers. These days, these file types aren't that popular anymore. Everyone is aware that malware resides on them, or they are frequently used for malware. So for that same reason, it's probably a good idea to block these as well, just to be safe. Another interesting one is multi-level encoding. Prior to PanOS 7.0, the firewall was able to decode up to 2 levels deep. Files exceeding this level would be allowed to bypass file blocking. Since PanOS 7, the maximum level has been increased to 4 levels. Now, as an example, a docx Word document in a zip file sent by email is 3 levels of encoding deep. A docx Word document zipped and sent through HTTP chunk encoding and gzip compression is 4 levels of encoding. Any file hidden in more levels of encoding can and should be blocked using multi-level encoding. So set that to block as well. Another cool trick that is frequently neglected is combining file blocking profiles with several different URL actions. Let me set these to block and create another profile that's going to allow PE files. And the second profile is going to block PE files. And then let's take a look at our URL filtering profile, where you can see a bunch of bad categories, like unknown, and of course malware, and private IP addresses, are going to be blocked. Many of these could potentially host malicious content, so it's a good idea to block these unless you need them. Let's go take a look at our security policy. As you can see, I have a couple of rules here. Let's take a look at the first one. This one is specifically designed to block files for a specific category. So in the destination, instead of a URL filtering profile, I have these in the destination. So any connection made to any of these URL categories will have a file blocking profile of block applied to them, which means that any connection going out will automatically will not be able to download any files. The reverse option is also possible. I have this second rule with a bunch of good URL categories with a different file blocking profile that allows the download of files. So this means I can have more control over which URL categories will be allowed to serve executables or other file types to users and which are explicitly blocked. And then below this, you'll see that I have a generic internet access rule that is going to apply a more generic policy. Maybe executable downloads are fine in my organization and I want to block only specific categories, or the reverse, no files are allowed to be downloaded except if they are for these specific categories. This way you can have more granularity in your security policy. I hope this video was interesting. Please let us know if there are any other file types you would like us to highlight for you. Thank you for watching.